You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello and welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Underwater wings of terror group pose threat to India's top ports. Pakistan not behaving as normal neighbor, says Indian MEA. India Bahrain condemn terror sponsoring countries in joint statement. And Pak-backed terrorism continues to hound Kashmiris. After getting repeatedly defeated by Indian Army in Kashmir, terror outfit Jaish-e-Mohammed is devising new strategy of attacking hinterland of India by using sea route. The Indian intelligence agencies have received inputs that an underwater wing of the Jaish-e-Mohammed is training its members to carry out attacks in India at the commands of their leaders and ISI from Pakistan. We bring you an exclusive report. After launching deadly Pulwama attack in February this year, Jaish-e-Mohammed is now training its sub-aquatic wing to execute large-scale attacks in India. Following the revelation about Jaish-e-Mohammed's latest devious design of terror against India, Indian Navy Chief and Admiral Karambir Singh assured the nation that Indian Navy's troops are ready to thwart any underwater attempt of attack by the Pakistan-based terror group.
हमें इंटेलिजेंस ये मिला है कि जो जो जैश मोहम्मद का जो अंडरवाटर विंग है एक वो जो ट्रेन कर रहे हैं इनको तो यही एक चेंज है पर हम अब निगरानी रख रहे हैं
वी शुड कीप अ वॉच ऑन द ट्रेनिंग व्हिच पाकिस्तान इज कैरिंग आउट टू ट्रेन इट्स अंडरवाटर विंग एंड आल्सो द विंग कमिंग फ्रॉम द सी एंड वी शुड इंश्योर दैट दीज अटैक्स आर स्टॉप्ड इन द ट्रैक we should also find out the exact place where this kind of a training is taking place and bring this proof in front of the whole world that such kind of a training is taking place. So we therefore should attempt to stop this kind of a training by getting adequate proof which can be put on to the world community so that these attacks are stopped in the track itself.
Speaking to the media on the sidelines of an event in Pune, Indian Navy Chief asserted that Indian coastal security personnel will not allow any kind of intrusion by any terror group. This is regardless of their maritime capabilities, which are largely supported by Pakistan's ISI. Since it is highly impossible to guard the entire sea, therefore, it is most feasible route for the terrorists to enter Indian territories and carry out underwater strikes. Reportedly, all major terror organizations operating from Pakistan receive training to boost their maritime capabilities. These terrorist organizations are being trained to carry out what is called Samundri or Seaborne Jihad against India. At present, Jaish-e-Mohammed and other Pakistan-based terror groups are having various waterway capabilities, which are a big threat for the country that are always at the target of these terror groups.
The Pakistani navies commandos train the underwater groups on the Pakistani coastline. There was once a report that at Bahawalpur, there is a certain number of terrorists were being trained for carrying out navigation in the sea, carrying out seamanship, carrying out terrorist act by the sea. So this kind of a specialized training is provided to the selected recruits by the Pakistani Navy and its naval commandos. One would recall that this kind of a training had taken place on 26-11 when the 10 terrorists which came from Karachi were trained by the Pakistan Navy. Then they came to India in a boat called Kuber, which had been captured by them by killing the owner. And thereafter they had landed up in Mumbai and carried out terror attacks.
The 2008 Mumbai attacks were carried out by Pakistani terror outfit Lashkar-e-Toyba, which sneaked into Mumbai through a sea route and launched a series of attacks which claimed the lives of over 160 people. Mentioning the deadly 2611 Mumbai attacks, Indian Admiral Singh said that the overall maritime security has been enhanced many folds to prevent any such incident in the future.
After the 2611 attacks in 2008, we set up this particular coastal security construct. It is doing very well as the Navy is overall in charge of maritime security, including coastal security. And along with Coast Guard, the Marine Police, the state government, and other stakeholders, we are doing our best to make sure that there is no intrusion from the seas.
Pakistan attempts to infiltrate terrorists both by land route and by the sea route. Now the land border is guarded properly. 95% of infiltrators get killed on the line of control itself, and a very small number is able to infiltrate into Kashmir. So therefore, Pakistan will always find out newer routes by which to enter India. So sea routes is another important option. And very recently, there was a report that 6 terrorists, out of which 5 were Sri Lankans and 1 was a person of Pakistani origin, by sea they had infiltrated into Kerala. Thereafter, they went to Karnataka and so on and so forth. So therefore, this threat is definitely real, and they are trying to use the sea route because infiltration from there is comparatively more easy than the land route.
India remains to be the constant target of dreaded terror organizations from Pakistan. The terror outfits have once again become proactive and are receiving huge amount of funding and support from Islamabad, who have upped their arms against India after recent developments in the status of Kashmir. Pakistan's bid to infiltrate terrorists in Jammu and Kashmir is causing extreme disruption in the valley. Innocent people are suffering due to continuous ceasefire violations from Pakistan's side, and the Indian Army has been put on high alert looking at the constant infiltration attempts by the terrorists at LOC. The Indian Ministry of External Affairs in its weekly press briefing said that Pakistan is trying its best to take advantage of the changed situation in Kashmir by propagating the idea of jihad to incite violence in the valley.
Addressing a weekly media briefing in New Delhi, Indian MEA spokesperson Ravish Kumar said that Pakistan should refrain from passing remarks on internal matters of India as they intend to project an alarmist situation in Kashmir. Kumar, on behalf of the Ministry of External Affairs of India, also advised Pakistan to start behaving as a normal neighbor.
We strongly condemn the highly irresponsible statements made by the Pakistani leadership on matters internal to India. These statements include references to jihad and to incite violence in India. This is intended to project an alarmist situation which is far from the ground realities.
Statement from the Indian MEA has come in the aftermath of repeated infiltration bids from Pakistan at the behest of Pakistan Army that has resorted to constant ceasefire violations at the borders, leading to disrupted lives of people living across the LOC.
It is important for them to now start behaving like a normal neighbor. What do the normal neighbors do? You know, you don't push terrorists into a neighboring country. You do normal talk, you do normal trade. But this is not something which is happening from Pakistan. I think we would like them to behave what a normal neighbor should do in such circumstances.
In spite of getting condemned at the highest platforms of the world for its habit of exporting terror, Pakistan continues to use terrorism as state policy against India.
The peace pact between Taliban and US is edging closer to end 18-year-long war in Afghanistan. The ninth round of peace talks between the US and Taliban has begun with an aim to secure withdrawal of foreign troops from Afghanistan against Taliban's guarantee to drop arms. However, the Taliban terrorist party to no peace process continue to wage attacks in Afghanistan. We have a report.
As US and Taliban negotiators push to wrap up talks aimed at securing the withdrawal of foreign forces from Afghanistan, disagreement remains about whether a pact will mean an end to the insurgents' fight with the US-backed Afghan government. US and Taliban officials have been negotiating in Qatar since last year on an agreement centered on the withdrawal of US forces and an end to their longest ever war in exchange for a Taliban guarantee that international militant groups will not ploy attacks. US negotiators have been pressing the Taliban to agree to peace talks with the Kabul government and to a ceasefire, but a senior Taliban official said that it would not happen. We will continue our fight against the Afghan government and seize power by force, said the Taliban commander on condition of anonymity. There are fears among Afghan officials and US national security aides that a US troop withdrawal could see Afghanistan plunged into a new round of civil war that could herald a return of Taliban rule and international militants, including Islamic State. Another Taliban commander, who also declined to be identified, said a deal was expected to be signed under which US forces providing support to Afghan troops will stop defending Afghan establishment. Under the pact, the United States would also cease supporting the Afghan government, the Taliban official said. The Americans will not come to the assistance of the Afghan government and its forces in their fight against us. Around 14,000 US troops in Afghanistan provide training to Afghan forces and conduct counterinsurgency operations. 17,000 troops from NATO allies and partners assist in mission called Resolute Support in Afghanistan. Gauging whipped-up Taliban attacks on US-supported Afghan establishment, the top US general, during a news conference at Pentagon, claimed that it was too early to talk about withdrawal of US counter-terrorism forces in Afghanistan.
So I think it's premature. I'm not using the withdrawal word right now. I'm using, we're going to make sure that Afghanistan is not a sanctuary, and we're going to try to have an effort to bring peace and stability to Afghanistan. We have enduring security interests in the region, diplomatic interests in the region, and economic interests in the region. And the form of our presence to advance our interests in those areas is going to change over time. And so any discussion about capability is going to be benchmarked against the threat, but as importantly, against the capacity of our partners in Afghanistan to deal with that threat. So could we talk conceptually about a time in the future when the Afghan security forces can deal with security in their country by themselves? You can, but we're not prepared to have a specific conversation about when that may be or what capability would be associated with what operating environment.
The general also emphasized on enhancing capability of Afghan forces in dealing with security situation in the country before conceptualizing any troop withdrawal. Negotiations over how to end the 18-year war in Afghanistan have been held in Doha since late last year. The ninth round of peace talks are underway as deadly attacks from Taliban insurgents are on a rise in the country.
In a major diplomatic embarrassment for Pakistan, the country is being called out repetitively by global leaders for its state-sponsored terrorism. In the latest humiliation to Pakistan, India and Bahrain called on the international community to reject the use of terrorism against other countries, which was indirectly a sharp attack on Pakistan and its use of terrorism to create havoc in other countries, a report.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently visited Bahrain, where the two countries agreed to join their hands in fighting terrorism. India and Bahrain, without naming Pakistan, called on states to stop using terror as an instrument of state policy in what can be viewed as a shot in the arm for New Delhi amid Pakistan PM Imran Khan's rhetoric on Kashmir. The two countries also launched sharp attack on terror-sponsoring countries without naming anyone.
This is a huge success story as far as India's diplomacy is concerned and a monumental embarrassment for Pakistan. Bahrain has been one of the biggest benefactors of Pakistan along with UAE and Saudi Arabia. And its turning against Pakistan is clear indication of the mighty success that Modi government has been able to achieve in the Middle East.
The joint statement issued by India and Bahrain categorically condemns terrorism in all its forms and manifestations, regardless of the identity of the perpetrators and their motives. They agreed to further enhance cooperation in the field of security, counter-terrorism and the exchange of intelligence and information. The two sides also noted the need for concerted action by the international community against terrorism, including through early adoption of the UN Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism, and underlined the importance of comprehensive sanctioning of terrorists and the organization by the UN.
India has been able to marginalize Pakistan to such an extent that nobody supports Pakistan, whether in the United Nations Security Council or any big or small nation. GCC countries, which are essentially Muslim countries, nobody supported Pakistan. Even Pakistan's all-weather friends like Saudi Arabia, Turkey, UAE, Bahrain have categorically indicated that Kashmir is an internal problem of India and it ought to be resolved bilaterally. This has been a setback for Pakistan. The Muslim countries are no longer with Pakistan on the issue of terrorism.
The support of Bahrain besides UAE is also significant in strengthening India's position against Pak-sponsored terror and its attempt to push infiltrators in the backdrop of moves in Kashmir by the Modi government. India and Bahrain categorically rejected the use of terrorism against other countries and asked for dismantling of terrorism infrastructure where they happen to exist and to cut off any kind of support and financing to the terrorists perpetrating terrorism from all territories against other states. The two countries also mentioned about bringing perpetrators of acts of terrorism to justice.
Terrorism is a threat for humankind and humanity. It's the biggest threat to mankind. It is causing a lot of economic loss to nations across the globe. And Pakistan continues to be the epicenter of it.
India is receiving humongous support from all the global platforms in its fight against terrorism. Not only India's friends, but even Pakistan's close allies like UAE and China have been condemning terrorism and terror-sponsoring countries repeatedly and have shown commitment in bolstering India's fight against terrorism.
After Indian administration abrogated Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir, enabling the Indian state to receive direct benefits from the center, rattled Pakistan has started whipping religion as a tool to proliferate terrorism in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. The region has been witnessing violent anti-India campaigns launched by Islamabad under a systematic scheme to crush the freedom movement Kashmiris have upheld against Pakistan for years. We have a report.
Pakistan's nefarious agenda of using religion to nurture and proliferate terrorism has deeply hurt the interests and ambitions of Kashmiris. They have not just been suffering to the violent anti-India campaigns launched by Islamabad, but a systematic design has also crushed their movement seeking freedom from the clutches of Pakistan. The Kashmiri leaders who left the region after Pakistan's establishment hounded them accused Pakistan of using the gullible youth of Kashmir as cannon fodder to wage a war against India. They say that Kashmiri youth is brainwashed in the name of religion.
जब 90 के दहाई में militancy शुरू की गई वैली के अंदर तो हमारी जो पार्टी है मुत्तहिदा कश्मीर पीपल्स नेशनल पार्टी, हमारा एक वाज़े मौक़िफ़ था कि ये कश्मीरियों की आज़ादी की जंग नहीं है, ये पाकिस्तान की प्रॉक्सी वार है और हमें इसका हिस्सा नहीं बनना चाहिए। इससे कश्मीरियों को कुछ नहीं मिलना, ये कश्मीरियों की तबाही और बर्बादी की जंग होगी। लेकिन जो जिस तरह मैंने कहा, जो तारीखी मगालतों का शिकार हैं, जो आज भी कन्फ्यूज़ हैं कि उनको कौन सा रास्ता इख्तियार करना चाहिए, वो उस वक़्त अल कताल अल जहाद के नारे लगा रहे थे। और हम ये समझते थे कि चूंकि रियासत जम्मू एंड कश्मीर कसीरल मजहबी और कसीरल कौमियती और कसीरल कल्चरल जो है ना, मल्टी कल्चरल स्टेट है, तो उसके अंदर मज़हब को हवा देने का मतलब ये है कि आप उस रियासत की तकसीम की बुनियादें मजबूत कर रहे हैं, जो पहले से ही कहीं ना कहीं मज़ाहिब के दरमियान छोटे मोटे इख्लाफात होते हैं, तो उनको आप जब हवा देंगे तो उसका मतलब ये है कि आपको उस रियासत के लोगों के साथ कोई हमदर्दी नहीं है या उसको आप यूनाइट नहीं करना चाहते।
The organizations like Lashkar-e-Tayyaba, which are now amongst most dreaded terrorist groups, were floated in the 80s in the name of Kashmiri welfare. But everybody knows what they are fighting for. Locals say that their movement was crippled by such organizations, as Kashmiris were dubbed internationally as terrorists and the region became infamous due to this only.
हम चीख चीख के ये कहते रहे कि ये जो नॉन स्टेट एक्टर्स हैं, जो पाकिस्तान के खुफिया अदारे जिनको जम्मू कश्मीर के अंदर स्मगल कर रहे हैं, इनसे हमारी कौमी आज़ादी की तहरीक जो है वो सबोताज हो रही है। ये कौमी आज़ादी से हट के दुनिया इसको एक दहशतगर्दी के उस पर देख रही है, हमारी कोई बात नहीं मानेगी। और फिर 9/11 के बाद वो सब जब कुछ मंजरेआम पर आया, हमारी तहरीक जो है बहुत पीछे चली गई, हमारी कुर्बानियों पे पानी फेर दिया गया। हम तब भी सरापा एहतजाज थे, आज भी सरापा एहतजाज हैं।
पाकिस्तान कंटिन्यूज टू होल्ड अ सिग्निफिकेंट पोर्शन ऑफ कश्मीर अंडर इट्स कंट्रोल एंड इट हैज बीन मेटिंग आउट अ नोवेकल ट्रीटमेंट टू द पीपल लिविंग हियर। दे आर डिप्राइव्ड ऑफ फंडामेंटल राइट्स एंड आर नॉट गिवन सर्विसेज एंड फैसिलिटीज एट पार विद द पीपल इन द अदर पार्ट्स ऑफ द रीजन। They do not have any representation in the parliament and their pleas and demands are not rendered any attention. They are not eligible for even key posts in the region. The ruling dispensation, which had promised of undoing the wrong done with Kashmir, has not just been ineffective but has stepped up cruelty to a newer level, which has induced unprecedented plights for the people. As of now, the future of the occupied Kashmiris hangs in balance with no light at the end of the tunnel.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Surbhi Sharma, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.